Necroptosis is a form of programmed necrosis, and therefore a messy form of cell death with cytoplasm spilling out of the cell. Necroptosis occurs in two cases, viral infections and ischemia reperfusion damage. In both cases, it is impossible for the cell to enter apoptosis. In the first case, this is due to some viruses, as for example cytomegalovirus, producing anti-apoptotic proteins as the viral version of FLIP that inhibits caspase 8. While in the second case, ischemia reperfusion damage can apparently damage the molecular mechanism of caspases and prevent cells from apoptotic death. When the cell cannot enter apoptosis but has to die for the organism's sake, it opts for necroptosis, which is extremely inflammatory. But inflammation is not always a negative thing. In fact, when viral, necroptosis is preferred to apoptosis, because in this way the inflammatory system is notified of the viral damage, and the arrival of the inflammatory cells will allow an efficient response against the virus. Necroptosis is triggered by TNF receptor 1 through its interaction with TRDD, which will attract RIPK1. This molecule is a kinase and it attracts RIPK3. The two of them phosphorylate each other, and once phosphorylated, they detach themselves from TRDD and form a dimer. More RIPK1, RIPK3 dimers get together, forming a beta-pleated sheet structure called necrosome. Necrosome functions like a kinase and not like a caspase. In fact, it does not work by cleavage but by phosphorylation. One of its effects is on the phosphorylation of the mixed lineage kinase-domain-like protein, MLKL. The phosphorylated molecules form trimers. These trimers insert in the cell membrane and form pores through which cytoplasm is spilled out of the cell, leading to the extrusion of all death-associated molecular patterns, that is to say, all damaged proteins and all the cytoplasmatic proteins that release outside activate the immune system by means of search and phagocytosis. These signals are in fact also called find me, eat me. Necroptotic death doesn't lead to membrane rupture as a necrosis, but to controlled formation of pores. In terms of inflammation, it is just like necrosis, since the released molecules lead to tissue invasion by inflammatory cells. Moreover, inflammatory cells attracted by these molecules don't carry out a simple phagocytosis, but a micropinocytosis, and therefore phagocyte large quantities of extracellular liquid containing the molecules leaked from the dead cell. These molecules are then exposed to MHC class II antigens. So necroptosis induces a powerful activation of the adaptive immune system. This activation is actually its goal, since necroptosis arises in order to alert the immune system. What we've seen until now is only one of the possible pathways of necroptosis. This form of cell death may be triggered by different things as well, as for example the interferon alpha and interferon gamma receptors. Another possible activation is that of toll-like receptors, which are receptors of the genetic immunity. Among these, there are toll-like receptor 4 that can perceive the bacterial lipopolysaccharide and the toll-like receptor 3 and 9, which are endosomal receptors. The toll-like receptor 3 can read the presence of the dsRNA, that is to say the double-stranded RNA, which is only viral. On the other hand, toll-like receptor 9 is able to read the double-stranded DNA that is usually released by pathogens when they are destroyed. All these signals, although through ways that are not always well understood, lead to necrosome activation and pore formation, thanks to the mechanism that we've seen earlier. Necrosome is capable of activating ANT, adenine nucleotide translocase, the inner part of the mitochondrial pore, increasing its affinity for cyclophilin D. The opening of the inner part of the pore inevitably leads to the melting of the external part. Then, the complete transition pore forms. This pore leads to water inflow into the mitochondrion to its osmotic rupture to a phenomenon of necrosis, not apoptosis. Moreover, the necrosome can break the lysosomes interacting with the molecules to stabilize the membrane. Necroptosis is a form completely independent from apoptosis, so the two types of cell death regulate each other. Caspase 8 is capable of inhibiting RIPK1. And similarly, RIPK1 is capable of activating CFLP that blocks caspase 8. However, the RIPK1 expression increases caspase 8 expression. Apparently, the inhibitor of the apoptosis protein, IAP, is capable of blocking both apoptosis and necroptosis. Apparently, necroptosis has an extremely important role that seems to be linked to the early graft versus host reaction. During these types of surgery, the organ undergoes ischemia. However, when vascular bandicles are linked, this organ is perfused again. This phenomenon is nothing but ischemia reperfusion damage, since the organ has gone through a lack of oxygen and blood, and then suddenly restored. Early death from grafts is apparently linked to necroptosis following ischemia reperfusion damage. The countercheck of this link is that by inhibiting interaction between cyclophilin D and the mitochondrial membrane pore, it is possible to reduce mortality. This blockage is possible through cyclosporin, an old immunosuppressor. However, administering cyclosporin right after transplants can apparently block one of the most important drivers of necroptosis, especially with ischemia reperfusion damage. In fact, cyclosporin seems to be capable of removing cyclophilin D from its binding site with ANT, thus blocking the driver. The countercheck is the increased survival rate in those patients.
Thank you for watching. This video was created by School of Biomedical Sciences Agora. We hope you enjoyed it. If you're curious or have any doubt or question, please feel free to leave a comment below. If you want to find out more about us or want to support our project, click on the following link to visit our website.